Welcome everyone to the HWBOT World Series 26 in Asia Pacific. We will be soon seeing the bronze match here in Yogyakarta. I'm Shufman from Overclocking TV, and before the match starts, I'm being joined by Lucky Noob. Hey Lucky Noob, how are you doing?
Hi guys. Pretty good. Still pretty much very tired, but I'm enjoying the show and then enjoying the match as well. Yeah, pretty interesting stuff happening. So yeah,
that was quite fun to see the two first match, the one between Speed Fastest and B-Boy Stess. What was the thing that surprised you the most in this first match? Because I was quite expecting B-Boy Stess to achieve and go to the grand final, but surprisingly it did not.
But okay, so basically Speed Fastest is he's from the AOCT 2014, I think. And then after that, he started to, you know, doing really well and keep posting in like HWBOT and making like low clock challenges like for efficiency. And lately, I think it's a year ago that he decided to, okay, I'm going to go extreme. And after that, he started to make, you know, quite a really, really a good score, you know, like efficiency score, and especially with the memory tuning with the ASUS motherboard. So it's like his specialty, and I was quite surprised about how well he tuned the memory in the Geekbench 3 stage, because the CPU clock and the cache is limited to 5.5 gigahertz. I mean, the only one difference you could make is by the memory, by tuning the memory. And you see that the memory we use today is the Corsair Vengeance LED 2666CL16.
Yeah, 2666.
Yeah.
A lot of six in that one.
Yeah. And then that's the same memory that we use in the AOCT as well. So in the AOCT, we see people tuning that memory to 3000, 3100, but never 3333CL12. So that was super tight.
Yeah, that was super tight
and almost like a Samsung EDI.
And the memory was not under LN2 at all. The memory was just like regularly with the like just plug in the plug
just
in the
plugged
system.
In. It's no LN2 at all. So it's I saw I think a glimpse of its timings, and the secondary and the tertiary is like super tight. I think in the first 10 or 15 minutes here, he's having problems, booting up, but he keeps retrying. And at that one retry, the memory managed to boot, and he goes to OS, to the Windows. And then after that, he go to like a really crazy score. So his Geekbench memory score is like 7.5 or 7.600, and that's really high for a memory that's not really, memory with like Micron IC. So it's really, really, really impressive.
That was, actually even for us, it was at the beginning, like lagging behind to submit the first score. B-Boy Stess was super fast at actually submitting the score and then building up on that. So do you think that's the different approach as well? Like Speed.Fastest wanted to really push as much as he can these sub timings before getting into the score system, even though that's something quite risky in a 30-minute matches.
Well, for me, if I were them, I mean, it will be like a gamble, you know, a pre-calculated gamble, if you will. So if I manage to get these settings in the first 10 minutes, then I'll go with that. If it's not working, no, change the plan. Plan B. So I think B-Boy is trying to make maybe just to be on the safe side. He, you know, like going to the score and score and score and score. And it's pretty consistent. It's really good. I mean, for live competition with a really short time like this, that's what you would expect. That's what I do. That's what I will do. But I think he maybe by doing that, he missed the bit about, you know, really pushing the memory. So he was like, okay, this maybe from like 0 from 100, BYGs only use about 90% of its potential just to be safe. So he didn't spend too much time troubleshooting like Raf in the match against Hazan previously. Yeah.
That's tough for these guys. I mean, We are here. Some are here like locals. Some are here like say Speed.fastest is an ex-amateur. Is that someone that you train personally as well?
Well, basically Speed.fastest is well, he's the guy that I train in AOCT. But after that, he does by himself. Well, for B-Boy G's, I think I've been training him since 2011 and until MOA 2014. But that's it. He already graduated. He actually in live setting like this, he would beat me any day, easily. Like that. So because you know, in the like 30-minute match like this, when I was in the stage with Peter, you know, announcing the scores for the local audience as well, I was feeling like the tension. I was thinking if I were in their shoes doing that, I was like, okay, I will be, you know, I will be trembling all over the place.
Especially for these guys, that's the first time they do this one versus one thing. They are on stage, they are here, there's the people coming, passing by and cheering at them. It's something completely new for the overclockers. I mean, not that many overclockers experience this kind of one versus one match so far. So did you like these kind of matches so far?
Of course. Definitely. I mean, back in 2015, I was trying to think of a way to make overclocking is like more like, well, almost like a game. So usually in the overclocking competition, you need to test the overclockers, not only the hardware, right? So by making the competition like one versus one with 30 minutes and, you know, like unknown ICs in the memory we use right now, it really stresses out the overclocker. So,
like,
yeah.
Especially like we did talk a little bit about that there's the hardware lottery, something that we used to call the hardware lottery, that you can get a super powerful system that's clocking super high just because you had the luck out of picking one. This does not exist here. This is actually like controlled, like in the control environment. You did test most of the CPUs.
Yeah, I did all test all the CPU. I think you saw me last night still testing the CPU, and I already previous day I already make sure all the CPU does 5.5 G limit. It does that easily. With -90 or -80,
Basically everyone can achieve 5.5.
Everyone
on
can
the CPU.
Achieve, yep.
And then they have to tune down the memory.
Tune down the memory and maybe tweak the OS a bit, maybe, because I'm not really sure with the, because we have 3D Mach 11 physics, we have Geekbench 3, we have two Cinebench, the R11.5 and R15, and also we have maximum memory clock. You know, I was kind of hoping that in the next match we'll see maximum memory clock.
Let's actually have a look at all the benchmark that
we can have.
So there is 6 benchmark that can be picked up from the draw: XTU, 3D Mark 11 Physics, Cinebench R11.5 and R15, Geekbench 3, and Max Memory Clock. So far, we have seen Geekbench 3 in the first semifinal, and Cinebench and 3D Mark 11 Physics for the second semifinal. What can happen for the bronze final is, you say, like, your favorite will be the max memory clock.
Maximum memory. I really wanted to see how this memory work in the, you know, in the maximum memory clock setting. Because 3D Mark 11 Physics, Geekbench, and XTU is basically the same. I mean, it's not the same benchmark, but the priority,
workload,
the workload is quite the same. I mean, Geekbench obviously is more, the memory tuning is more, you can see the effect of memory tuning. Because in the Geekbench 3, there is a dedicated memory score. So I think I like that benchmark, because for me, I'm a memory reviewer. So you can see the memory score clearly, and you can see the effect of your, you know, timing and what you tweak in the BIOS to see, okay, now the memory is working or not. And then is my memory setting too loose or it's too tight and making it unstable? So yeah, I was really hoping that the maximum memory clock came out.
I'm kind of expecting for it as well, because that means we're gonna see a lot of blue screens.
Yeah, of course. We can shout blue screen all day. But also the XTU is going to be really really interesting. And also, XTU Cinebench and R11.5 and R15 is going to be very interesting, because those put a really, really heavy load on the CPU, especially the XTU. And you know what? the thing with Skylake and the high load benchmark like Cinebench and XTU is if you put too much voltage and load at certain temperature, the internal TIM between the die and the IHS, it's the heat spreader, can break, and then making the contact between the core and the IHS really bad.
So that's what we call the crack. So it's because of the temperature difference between the cooling part and the part that is producing the heat.
So
if someone run into that, they would have some strong issue because they would have to basically unmount everything and fix
it. And they have to pull the IHS and then they repaste the internal TIM. But I try to minimize that by using this old CPU they have already pre-deleted. Deleted and repasted with Thermal Grizzly Cryonaut. So I expect no cracking, hopefully.
Awesome. So we will soon be starting that game. You're staying with us for the next 10 minutes?
Maybe 10 minutes, yeah, sure.
All right, so Lukenov will stay with us for the next 10 minutes. Buildzoid will join us for the commentary of this match as well. Let's tune in to Peter, that is the judge of this event, and he will do the benchmark draw for this third match of today, bronze.
All right, let's pick the benchmarks. Hands off the system. Just close the. All right, so we have six benchmarks, just like last time. Memory Clock, Cinebench R15, Cinebench 11.5, Geekbench 3, Multicore, 3D Mark 11 Physics, and XTU. Rev, you have the first right of veto, and then you have the second right of veto. Let's pick the first benchmark. Geekbench 3, Multicore.
Okay. Please veto that. Please veto that. Please veto that. Pretty please.
He keeps it. What do you do?
Ah,
do you like it as well? All right.
Why?
All right. Hold on. Don't touch it yet. Let's do the count. Don't touch it yet. All right. 3, 2, 1, start.
So here we go. Whoa, 30 here minutes we go. Of Geekbench 3 multicore. So that's going to be the same benchmark that we have seen in the first match.
Yeah, and the B-boy, already.
People just already know it. So it's like, yes. That's why he was having a big smile when the benchmark was chosen.
If I were Raf, I will veto that benchmark like right away.
Because you already B-boy. Have the experience on it.
Yeah.
So let's tune in on the system of the guy. So, Lucky Noob, you are an extreme overclocker as well. What is happening in the first few minutes of these games? What do they have to do because the system is above ambient at ambient temperature?
Definitely memory profile. So basically, you see in the previous match, Raf set that memory like manually after the competition has been for like 10 minutes or so, and that's like really. I mean, that's the misjudgment.
16-494.
I gotta go.
We already got a score.
Boy, really fast. And then the memory score is 7,000, almost 7,100. It's quite okay, I think. His first run is okay-ish, I think. Yeah. So we are screen at the B-boy. Is he on the BIOS? I expect they will. This is the BIOS of the.
So the blue team is B-Boy Chdes, and the red team is RevOC. And this is what is live. Yeah. So we can see all the screens. So all the screens can see you guys. You guys can see. So B-Boy Chdes is back in the BIOS. So what is going on for the BIOS? He's loading the profile.
I think he's loading the profile. So it's a pretty good move from B-Boy because if you have profile, then you will definitely cut off, a couple minutes of, BIOS tweaking, and that is really good. If I were in this competition, I will definitely set up like 3 or 4 memory profile beforehand because they are given about 30 minutes to test, although it's in ambient temperature, so they cannot cool down. But they could still make a really good memory profile out of it. So I think B-Boy, Hazan, and Speed already has the same strategy. The only thing that didn't do that is Ref. It's maybe because this is like his first extreme overclocking competition. So
come on, it's the first extreme overclocking competition he does. Did he try extreme overclocking before?
Nope.
So that's the first time he's using LM2.
Yeah. So basically, like yesterday, it's practically the first day he do like a qualifier, live qualifier. But the thing I like is Ref asked me before this work tour is happening. He said, "Okay, I wanted to do this competition, but I don't have any equipment." He tried to buy one, but usually if you ship it, then sometimes it can get lost. So he asked me to lend my equipment. So actually, I lent my equipment to a lot of overclocker yesterday. The one is like from the UNS one, and also the amateur one that I teach to do LM2 overclocking, and also to refs. So yeah,
that's crazy. So basically, the guy is competing on the system that you just lent him, and is actually managing to be in the bronze final.
Yep.
Wow, that's quite impressive.
How long the benchmark takes? 30 seconds.
So the
first score for Rev OC 17.963.
He's already at 5G. We see here. It's already at 5G, it's pretty good. But the memory score is like lower than B-Boy. So I think the memory is not really optimal yet for Rev. Yeah, that's only 5G, so it's valid.
Score for B-Boy. 18.059.
Whoa, nice.
So B-Boy submitted the first score, then Rev OC submitted a strong score, and now B-Boy is back in the lead.
Yeah,
back in the lead.
But you
strong
know,
score.
We got Blueski! Nice. Okay, but anyway, those two will be fighting at 5.5G, both in the CPU and cache. So we expect 19,000 ish in the score, something like that. So yeah. So Ref here have a DRAM frequency of 3200, and that's pretty good. The B-Boy also at 3200. So I think the thing that will separate those two is the timing and the sub timings. This is going to be a really close battle, I think. Really close battle.
So they're both into the BIOS, so we can see the difference in the BIOS here. The Asus one on the blue team at B-Boy's desk, the MSI one on the red team for Rev OC. So once again, B-Boy's desk going into the profiles.
Yeah, so it's almost like he knew the memory and he said, okay, this is the baseline. This will boot. So after he loads that, he fine-tuned it to the setting he like and to the maximum efficiency of his memory and the system. I think that's a really good way to, you know, do a competition like this. It's definitely needed.
So that means he's becoming prepared as well for this competition.
Of course. We see the score is like really close between between B-Boy and Ref.
There is 24 minutes left in this competition so far. Both have a score pretty close, like less than 100 point difference between the two.
That's what I said. This one is going to be a really close match, I think.
Even though that's two different approach at benching.
Yeah, and they use two different motherboard also. The Ref use MSI Z170A X Power, and then B-Boy just use Asus Maximus 8 Impact. So. Whoa, the memory is good. The CPU clock speed is good.
3.2 GHz C16.
Yep.
Was that C16 or C12?
C12, I think. C12.
I think it was C12, yeah.
This one should be 19,000 something if it's if the B-Boy JS run is good. So yeah, we'll see.
So it's not very visual.
Geekbench is not really visual.
A loading bar and a counter of the elapsed time for calculating the
it's a pretty boring bench, but well, it puts a lot of stress to the CPU and memory as well. So I think Ref here only have 5.4, less than 5.4 CPU. I'm not sure why he does that. Maybe it's on the safe side.
New score for B-Boy Jazz.
Whoa, 19949. And the memory score is 7,300. That's pretty efficient.
So that's a huge jump in score. It jumped more than 1,000 points.
Yeah. So Raf will finish his run soon. Raf will definitely finish his run. Yeah, in a couple seconds.
Your score for Rev OC. 19134.
Whoa, 19. But the memory score is still less than 7,000. He needs more.
So that means if he's pushing his memory to a bit higher and tighter.
But I notice here. That B-Boy doesn't really adjust the tertiary timing. Maybe he's on the safe side because the tertiary timing in this memory is needed because the memory is dual-sided. So there is a lot of ICs in the memory. It makes a really heavy load on the IMC. So usually the motherboard will adjust to make it looser timing for the tertiary timing.
And that means it can be stable, it can boot, and it can work.
Yeah. So it's just like I say, it's a bit of a gamble. If you manage to tune in the tertiary, you will get the efficiency like speed has. Yeah. Oh. Okay, it's only 21 minutes, 20 minutes and 57 seconds, I think, yeah. That's pretty good. B-Boy is at the Windows and starting to boot his system. Raf is good. He managed to boot the system a lot now because in the match against Hazan, he spent
time. He was struggling a lot.
And I think he learned from that mistake and put the memory profile, I think, yeah. So, well, that's good learning. So
let's see
the
frequency of Rev OC.
Okay,
5.5.
Yep, 5.5. Yeah, that's good. Okay, and B-Boy also pretty good.
Here we go. Rev OC benching Geekbench 3. He need to put a score on the scoreboard that is higher than 19,646 points to beat B-Boy's test. At least if he's doing more than 19,134, that means he will improve his score, both of the overclocker benching side by side today.
Yeah, little bit more. No, do we get a blue
crashed?
Screen? No, crashed.
I think it just crashed, completely crashed.
Oh, okay.
That's sad.
And B-Boy is almost finishing his run.
New score from B-Boy Jess. 19733.
Nice. Nice. You see the CPU speed of the ref is bugging, I think. It shows to 26 gigahertz. That couldn't be right.
We'll try to catch that one on the live earlier, a little longer after.
Yeah.
I think you have to go back on the stage to do the commenting. Thank you very much for your time. Thank you very much for this
See you
commentary.
In the final match, maybe. Hopefully.
Yeah, for sure. That would be fun to have you there for the final match.
Okay, sure. See ya.
Buildzoid. So here we are back at it, commenting that game. We have Rev OC 19,134 points in Geekbench 3 multicore against B-Boy Jess 19,733 points. Of course, this is an interesting match because B-Boy Jess is currently number 3 in the country and Rev OC is a complete outsider. Complete outsider is 40 in the country today. Let's see, because this is already back at benching. He will be submitting a score anytime soon. Peter will be announcing the score for it. He needs to push more than 19,733.
New score by... Oh, no, it's 4 points lower.
And that was a false alert. So yes, there's 18 minutes left in this match. That was actually going quite fast for the first 10 minutes. So let's focus a little bit more on the settings. Bibojdes is having all the settings. So 5.5 multiplier, 100 of the base frequency. His memory frequency is at 3.2 gigahertz. C12 is trying to increase the BCLK now. So the base clock, the reference clock. He need to make sure that he's not going above 5.5 gigahertz. This is the limit for today.
And it looks like 10.
I guess that means you still are having a slight delay.
Two crashed. I think what he's trying to do with the.
And it crashed.
Yeah, actually, it crashed. Just slight delay. It just dropped the stream completely for me. This is really not ideal. Oh, and I'm back. So that's. Good. Yeah, it's not so much that like what I'm seeing is delayed, it's more like what I'm seeing keeps freezing. So.
Well, at least you have the time to read the few settings in the BIOS because these guys are going super fast in the BIOS.
Except for the part where it froze on the loading screen. Not in the BIOS.
To overclockers focusing on the system. There's a nice trick by both of the overclockers. They try to use the tools provided by the Asus motherboard to get into the different settings super fast. So we can see that Bibojdes is adjusting, playing with his mouse. That is just for him to make sure it is not crashed. Go 100.13. Launching a Geekbench, selecting 64 bits, of course. That will yield more points as he can use more than 3 gigs of memory. Of course, they have 16 gigs of memory. That's funny because if you look at the memory, it says 15.6 gigs and minus 1 megahertz because it's clocked too high. So while Bibojdes is benching, we have RevOC going into the BIOS. Quickly using the F10 save settings. It's basically save and quit on most of the motherboard.
So it looks like Rev has just chosen a completely different strategy because he just dropped his multiplier to
new score from Bibojdes.
So new score from Bibojdes, but not improving his previous score. You were saying, Bitzoid, regarding Rev OC strategy. Oh, I think we lost Bilzoid again.
Rev was multiplier. I don't know if he's gonna if he plans to just do that to make it easier to get into Windows or if he just because I missed what he set for the BCLK, so I'm not sure if he decided to just crank up the BCLK really high and run the multipliers low to get some.
Bye.
Specific memory speed that he wants fine tuning.
New score by B-Boy Jazz, 19.738.
Well, it looks like B-Boy is starting to reach the upper limits of his system, because his last score was lower. This score was just a little bit higher. So it seems like...
Yeah, it seems like we are losing packets with you as well. I've been joined by Xiala here on the other side of the stage. Xiala, how is it so far for you watching this game?
Very, very good. I think I totally agree with what Bildred was just saying. It's indeed getting to the edge here. The like 2/3 of the times are already done, and usually, like you guys mentioned earlier, like the first 10 minutes go very quick. Everyone scores very quick. You make big step up, and after that, you slightly go lower again. So, and now they're going back up. So. But then again, it's very difficult to get those extra points. Only 5 points more on the last run for B-Boy Jess. We'll see how much this time RevOC is going to be able to get with that run. A run being about 30 seconds or so.
30 minutes, that would be long for a 30-minute game.
You will only have one shot at it.
Oh boy.
30 seconds.
So yeah, it's about like 30 to 40 seconds depending on the system that you're using. It's always the same workload, so the benchmark is always doing the same workload.
So some guys are asking, how come the stream keeps freezing? Well, because we are losing pigeons here from Indonesia to our servers in Singapore, actually, that are not that far if you consider the distance. And it's actually the shortest wire we have from here to there, with the lowest ping and the highest possible outwards bandwidth from the country. And it seems that it worked really well the last 2 days, but today, for some reason, I think there's too many people at work watching YouTube videos and being less productive in the second day of the week. And that because of that, I think we're having a hard time at getting a proper stable bandwidth.
We have a new score from RevOC.
So new score for RevOC, 19.261.
Yep, confirmed by Peter, 19.261. It's a little like improvement again. It's getting closer, but it's still very, very far anyway from what B-Boy is outputting here. I mean, like really in 9 minutes, truth, I don't know what we can expect, but it's going to be a very, very tough battle for us.
That's going to be a very tough battle indeed, because so far B-Boy Jazz is in the lead for quite some time, more than 15 minutes he's in the lead. We can't see RevOC coming back. He seems to have found a way to pass the psychological barrier of 19,000 points. Let's see if he can actually make it back into his profile.
So you can see it's going very quickly in the BIOS. You barely have the time to actually read the settings the guys are putting it. You just quickly scroll down, get where you want to go, change the settings, up, change from 42 to 60, oh no, actually 54. Up. That's actually a nice little menu there, right there. F10 to save and exit, and that's it, you reboot.
You basically press F10, right? The F10 is save and exit, so you basically...
You have to hit enter still after that. Because it prompts you if you really want to do that.
Do you want to apply?
So both computers are restarting. If the one doesn't come up, it's because... Let's have a little bit of issue booting up.
The first one to start is the one from RevOC. B-Boy Jazz is waiting to start the
system. Of course, the CPU speed you see at the top of the BIOS here is not correct. 26 gigahertz is obviously not right.
That's the fastest CPU ever made.
the fastest i5 for sure.
Like BuildZoid is back.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. The both contestants are restarting. It seems. Oh no! Then again,
restarting into the BIOS.
This time the CPU speed is correct. Well, 3.5 gigahertz. I'm not sure actually if it's exactly correct. Let's see if we can check his multiplier.
But it's okay. On RevOC, it's 1st of January 2015. and so you have a CPU at 26 gigahertz, everything is fine.
So it might not be the only thing that is displayed wrong in the BIOS.
Well, especially when they try to to push the system to the maximum, there's always some glitch appearing from time to time. Yeah.
And we saw very briefly also on the B-Boy's screen when he was in the BIOS, he slightly loosened the timings on his memory there. Probably trying to get it right. At the same time, RevOC is back in the BIOS again. This time, CPU speed seems correct, 5 GHz. Increasing the CPU SA voltage.
There's only 6 minutes and 45 seconds left in this bronze final. That would be a tight, still a tight battle, but B-Boy Des is in the lead for pretty much the majority of that game. Let's see if he will manage to stay in that lead for the complete round, unless RevOC submit a strong score in the next 6 minutes. I doubt this will change in the next time.
Yeah, and voltage is getting pretty slightly higher now again with RevOC at 1.725 volts. On the CPU, of course, if you're using an air cooler or an AIO at home, don't try that. RevOC is going through many liters of LN2 at the moment.
We have to remind that there's no limit on the amount of LN2 they can use, so they can basically go full in if they want, or full out, actually.
Yep. And that's it. Rev is entering Windows. Seems to be a very slow boot right there. I think he's... Yep. Did he had a crash on the booting screen? Yep, that was a crash, so going back into the BIOS, there's some things he might change there. Not to touching the CPU multiplier, but he's going to change something in the timings. His memory timings
Five
are
minutes
back
left.
To auto.
So he's starting at 5.5 GHz, so he's maybe still trying to dial in the timing of the memory rather than increasing the base clock and then the memory frequency. As Lucky Noob says, if you touch the tertiary timings in this benchmark, it can give you a little extra boost as well. So maybe that's what RevOC is going on for.
Yep, and someone is asking, what is this? Can someone explain? This is overclocking. So the whole goal here is to increase the performance of a computer by changing parameters such as CPU frequency, memory timings, or if you would overclock your graphics card, that could be your integrated graphics frequency, or for example your GPU graphic and memory frequencies. So the whole point here, it's a one versus one match, so it's to have a PC that performs faster than your opponent. We run benchmarks to measure the performance, it gives us a score, and we battle on who gets the best score, basically.
Well, basically it's who gets the biggest one.
It's just like running faster than your neighbor, it's basically exactly the same. So you can see the two guys today are using two different motherboards. So we have B-Boy Jess, blue color, who's using a Asus ROG Impact. And this is a mini ITX motherboard. On his opponent, RevOC, in the red color, he's using an MSI Z170A X Power Gaming Titanium motherboard. So both contestants could choose which board they wanted to use for this competition. The only limitation was among four selected brands. They are imposed to use the same CPU, which is drawn and provided to them before the match starts. Same goes for the memory kits that they are using as well, which were also drawn before the start. 3 minutes left in this game. This is
not
much.
3 minutes left.
It's going to just give them just enough time to basically...
Well, if we look at the scores for the past 10 minutes, there was not that many scores being put on the dashboard.
In the last 15 minutes, I saw only two scores. It was a 5-point increase by B-Boy and a few points also by Rebel C. So nothing really exciting really happened there. And this is what I am not a big fan also of Geekbench as well. It's not very visual.
But, yeah, it's not quite visual indeed.
It's also like it's something that takes a lot of reboots because you're tuning memory there. And it's something, yeah, where you won't see as many scores you could see, for example, on benchmark. That would be eventually graphic bound, and where you could do most of the tuning or tweaking straight from within Windows.
So here we are for Bibosh Death is at 3.2 GHz for the memory, CAS 12, so that's quite tight, and is at 5.5 GHz for the CPU. They're using the Intel Core i5-6600K, both of them use the same kind of CPU. Both CPU have been pre-tested to make sure they do pretty much the same, and they can both reach 5.5 GHz. So they can both do 5.5 GHz. Now it's up to the overclockers to show their skills in this OC game to make sure they can get the best score in Geekbench 3.
So there you can see B-Boy Jess. The opening back to Asus Turbo V-Core, which is an application that allows you to tweak quite a several amount of items that you find in your BIOS straight from Windows and Windows. This is a competitive advantage having a tool like that. It allows you to save time not having to reboot and go to the BIOS to change some of the parameters. You can do that straight live in real time from Windows and run the benchmark directly there. On the other side, you can see RevoC is using a similar tool. Oh, you already closed
the MSI Command Center.
It's a similar tool that gives you pretty much the same access, yeah.
So basically what's important for them is to have quick access to the settings to make sure they don't have to restart the system, lose some precious time within the 30 minutes of the game. Because there's only 40 seconds left in this one. They are both into the system, they are both benching. These are going to be the last score. The last call for Bibosh Death to stay in the lead or to RevOC to catch up on the third best overclocker in Indonesia.
Yep, and without being pessimistic there, I'm pretty sure we can say the French expression, les carottes sont cuites for our French.
Rien ne va plus.
Yep, it's going to be very hard to get those, it's pretty much almost 500 points there that he needs to get to go 19, where 2, he 9, wants 2. To go for a win. And 19, small improvement there, but going to make a difference, and it's over.
Oh my god, this is crazy. So you guys saw on RevOC the countdown was going down. The rules is as long as you press start on the benchmark before the countdown is over, your run will count. So he's going there to maybe improve his score. I don't think it will win, it will smash the score of Bibosh Death, but still this is quite impressive that at the last seconds. Wow, that is tight timing. So let's hope this run can finish and give him a better score than the 19,292 points he's having now. Wait for it. 19, oh my god, what a jump! 19,625 points. Wow, what a huge score. It just rerun the benchmark and then the scores went up. So there's a lot of things that can happen in the background, some extra settings or some extra process that is running in the background from time to time. This is why some of the overclockers prefer to just rerun. So that's what we call a second run. So they prefer to rerun their system at the exact same settings to sometimes gain have a lucky run and go faster. Whoa! GG, Bibosh Death. That was a tight battle. RevOC was no going back in, almost catching up with him. That was interesting to see the way he was putting this score on Geekbench 3 multicore. BuildZoid, you're back with us. What did you think about that that game? That was quite intense.
I mean, that last minute score was really, really surprising and very impressive that RevOC managed to pull out a score that is so close to B-Boy Jazz in the last seconds, and basically going into overtime to do it. I'm really impressed that he actually managed to get that score, because it sort of looked like he just couldn't, like there was no way he was going to be able to even keep up a 500 point difference in Geekbench. That's not a small amount. So at least it shows that, you know, if they had, like, it's not that he was like, you know, he it was close. It was essentially close. If he had discovered whatever got him that, you know, 19, the extra points at the on the very last run, if he had found that earlier, you know, this could have been very, very different. That's the thing with these overclocking
right?
competitions. Yeah, it's like you just never know. Like, you can have a score that's just ridiculously high come out of completely out of, you know, nowhere, because you found that magic setting or you managed to find that magic tweak for it. As I said earlier on today's stream, some benchmarks just prefer to be run multiple times. So, you know, if you know that, you can if you know that early on, you can really boost your scores without actually having to retune the system all over and over and over again. Because a lot of the time with overclocking, right, when you're doing it, you'll find that something is not the way you want it to. And it's just because you're going in the completely wrong direction with things, right? Like, sometimes you might be like, oh, I just need to throw more gigahertz and more voltage at it. And then you realize, oh, wait, it actually works better if I just, you know, stay at the same clock and pull down the voltage. There are some architectures that actually perform better if you do that, which is completely counterintuitive, but, you know, it's a thing. And so there's a lot of different variables, and it really... Yeah, but I meant, like, same temperatures, same power levels, right? And well, actually, power levels change with voltage, but basically, just by adjusting voltage, you drop your power levels. So, assuming same temperature and same frequency, you'd think there's no way there's a difference, especially if you're running a BIOS that has no power limit. And yet, sometimes there are here and there architectures that still benefit from running being run more efficiently on lower voltages. And basically, you see things like all the time with there's certain things in the OS that you can do that will just out of nowhere get you more better scores. So that makes this really, really exciting. And I mean, it's almost a comeback for RevOC. Is just very impressive to see in those very last seconds.
Yeah, maybe next time, you know, it's a learning experience. It was the first, I think it was the first time for him to be in a one versus one kind of setup like this.
Well, it was his first overclocking competition here.
So
it was the first time in one versus one as well. It's quite impressive that one guy that was not using liquid nitrogen 2 days ago managed to be in a bronze final here. So that means it is accessible to a lot of people, right? Once you put the time into it and you try to, you know, you do it, of course.
Even without, you know, because, I mean, like, if he only spend like 2 days on the LN2 to get there, it also proves that, you know, in that kind of very quick, fast-paced competition, sure, the experience influences a lot, and that's where you can see that B-Boy Jess, the experience was there because he knew how to get to that score. If you think about it, basically, RevOC stayed at the same score that B-Boy had on his first run. So B-Boy was at about that score, like the same score, 19200 something, and basically, I think on his third score, he was actually beating that one and setting it straight to 19600 and something. And then he just stayed there for most of the time. And I think, I don't know how much more time RevOC would have had to spend to get to close to him. But maybe you know, it
maybe
could
we
have been the luck
been,
of the beginning,
like,
you know?
The beginner's luck, like we say.
Beginner's luck, yeah. So
like we say in French, la chance du débutant.
Yes, I would be RevOC right now. Actually, he is exactly doing what I would do. His system is plugged on the other side, and he seems to be pouring LN2 into the pot. So he's actually, you can see him at the top there in the center. And he's actually benching again. So I'm pretty sure he's just keep on going his match. He's not going to stop there. He say, now he found out how to go higher. He's just going to keep on going. And that's exactly what he should do.
Well, what he's doing is exactly what we love to do, is to say that he keep pushing it.
Yeah.
Oops, guys, you can get some of this t-shirt on the Teespring store below the stream on Twitch TV, Overclocking TV channel. Thank you guys for being here with us. That game was intense, the bronze match. So we know that B-Boy Jess is third about this competition. RevOC the outsider, 40, ranked 40 in this country here in Indonesia, came out of nowhere, smashed the score on the first match, and now now like smashing close to Bibosh Des. That was quite impressive to see how he came back from far behind for a long time, struggling to get the system working correctly with the right settings. He spent at least 10 minutes trying to all the settings on the memory to make it start and boot. And in the end, he managed to be close by almost 500 points to Bibosh Des. Quite impressive display display of score. Tim, in one word, how you would you describe this game?
Epic.
Epic?
Epically interesting. It's going to be also what I'm mostly looking for after a game like this is going to see what the finals are reserving to us in terms of suspense and surprises. The final, we will see some two strong guy facing each other. So, of course, we have the leader of his league, pretty much, here in Indonesia.
Azan. And, number one overclocker in Indonesia, strong player on the international scene as well.
It's his second competition in a row, second World Series competition where he's in the finals. So this guy, he knows exactly how to get there. And now he just misses to have the right opponent, maybe, you know, to be able to actually grab the victory. And we'll see. I don't think his opponent is actually going to give him a go there. You know, it's going to be...
That's going to be a tough battle. I mean, what is at stake here is a ticket, the last remaining golden ticket for the HWBOT World Championship. This championship will be in Germany in the beginning of December. That's going to be the highlight of this HWBOT World Series season. After 7 events, that's going to be the biggest of the baddest of all the best overclockers. That's the final of the final, right? All the best overclockers will be there. Today, they're fighting to get the last remaining ticket on stake. Well, we will all be there for the stream, so we already know it's quite easy for us. But for these guys, that's the only chance they can go there. It will not be open to the public. It will just be an invitation only. It will just, honestly, that's the last chance they have today. Bildzoid, to close on this game, what would be your highlight of this one? In one word.
I mean,
in one word. Comeback? So epic comeback.
The epic comeback.
Epic comeback. So that's going to be the wrap-up for this game. The epic comeback from Rev OC against Bibosh Des. Thank you very much, guys, for being here with us. The next game will be the final here about the HWBOT World Series Asia Pacific qualifier. And it will be quite interesting to see what the guys have to do. Let's take a quick break and come back right after this.